the learned and even ever astute social theorist Philip Reeve once wrote a book review, and it went like this. The purpose of a book is to provoke thought. This book has not done so. And he signed it Philip Reeve. The purpose of a book, and by extension, the purpose of a lecture, is to provoke thought. My provocation today is about the science of morality, which underwrites the dominant psychologistic models for understanding character and for guiding the formation of character among the young. The discursive space created by the Jubilee Centre represents a rare and refreshing exception to the rule. It's not the only exception, but it is certainly prominent, and the space it provides is wonderful. But here is the rule. Since the early part of the 20th century, especially in the US, though increasingly elsewhere, psychology, both as a field of inquiry and as a set of practices, has become a paradigm in the sense intended by Thomas Kuhn in his Structure of Scientific Revolutions. By paradigm, Kuhn meant the assumptions, conceptual frameworks, exemplary figures, and experimental practices that underwrite what is considered the normal science of the day. A paradigm defines for a field what is reality, what is significant and insignificant, what are the relevant and irrelevant questions, what constitutes data and therefore what needs to be observed, and what can be safely ignored, how science is to be conducted, and how the results of scientific investigation should be interpreted. The larger question I am asking, for which this lecture is a small part, is this. Is this view, is this paradigm, adequate to the reality it seeks to understand? Is this paradigm adequate to the reality it seeks to understand? Are its models of practice adequate to the realities it seeks to influence? I am convinced it is not, that the paradigm is deeply flawed philosophically, conceptually, empirically, and substantively. How and why this is a topic for another time. But just by way of context, much of my work right now is oriented toward the development of an alternative paradigm for understanding and practicing the moral formation of the young. My concern today is limited. I want to focus on the new moral science that underwrites the paradigm of psychological monism. My objective here is to inquire into the nature of the science behind psychological approaches to character education, because if the scientific project is flawed, if it isn't adequate to the reality it seeks to understand, then not only will it be ineffective, but it can do enormous harm, and not least to the children who are the intended beneficiaries of that science. So what can be said about that science? For over 400 years, Westerners have been on a quest to find a scientific foundation for morality. Confidence in this project has waxed and waned over the centuries. But today we live in a time when that confidence is sky high. Public discourse is awash with books that claim to show how science can determine human values, that reveal the science of moral dilemmas, and that disclose the science of right and wrong. But what is actually new about all of this? The reality is that after 400 years, the science of morality has reached a theoretical stasis, framed by the conceptual architecture bequeathed by the three main schools of Enlightenment thinking on this matter: the psychologized sentimentalism of Hume, the evolutionary account of the mind from Darwin, and finally, as procedures for guiding human action, the utilitarian calculus of Bentham and Mill. To be sure, the general synthesis of these elements is novel, as are the technologies that aid its pursuit. But in terms of the conceptual tools that guide contemporary efforts to fix a scientific foundation for morality, the apparatus is familiar, if not by now conventional. It is within this paradigm, then, that moral and evolutionary psychology, primatology, and neuroscience operate, and where experimental insight presently accumulates. On the surface, the new moral sciences generated a great deal of intellectual excitement. But from my vantage point, there's less here than meets the eye. The reasons are many, though I want to focus on just one this afternoon, namely the conceptual problem of defining morality for scientific purposes. So here's my agenda. I want to do four things with the time that remains. First, I want to unpack some of the conceptual confusion that attends scientific and psychologistic understandings of morality, and to show how the new moral science tries to resolve that confusion, ultimately in a prudential ethics. Secondly, to discuss the foundations of moral authority upon which this prudential ethics rests. Thirdly, by extension, to discuss the very familiar ends to which this ethics has become oriented. Finally, I close by raising some questions about where this cultural logic leads us. Needless to say, my remarks will be truncated, as they always are in an academic lecture, but the hope is that in the end you will be provoked into thought and discussion, which we can pursue afterward. So first, conceptual confusion. Clarity and consensus is essential for any science. Biology would not be much of a science if biologists could never agree on the nature and meaning of a cell. Physics would not be much of a science if physicists could never agree upon the properties that define different forms of energy. Chemistry would not be much of a science if chemists constantly wrangled over the elements comprising the periodic table. And even if they could conjure agreement, these still would not be very good sciences if they failed to define the subjects of study in ways that were inadequate to the phenomena they wished to understand. In the same way, it is essential to a science of morality that morality be conceptualized in ways that fits the reality, that convincingly conceptualizes morality and other moral terms in a way that closely, if not accurately, describes what they are. The fact is, the term morality has several legitimate meanings, and which one is used has tremendous implications for what exactly a scientific theory of morality is really showing us. Consider three types, or different senses, of morality. First, morality can mean the realm of right and wrong, good and bad, whether these are grounded by fundamental moral laws or grounded by the value of particular things and states of affairs. This is the sense of morality meant when we say, for instance, that killing innocent people for fun is morally wrong, or that racism is immoral. This morality is prescriptive, meaning it is supposed to justifiably guide human action. Second, morality can mean the realm of social rules and practices, and those rules or decisions sanctioned by the things considered to be valuable, that describe what groups of human beings consider to constrain what is permitted or encourage what should be pursued or promoted. This is the sense of morality we meant when we talk about society's moral code, without intending to say anything about whether such a society's codes really are right and wrong. We might call this morality descriptive. Third, morality can mean something more practical or instrumental. In this sense, morality concerns what one should and shouldn't do, but where the should isn't a moral should in the lived or prescriptive sense. That is, there's a kind of ought that is practical without being ethically idealistic. It's the sort of ought we mean when we say things like, well, if you want to win the lottery, then you ought to buy a lottery ticket. In such cases, we aren't trying to say that anyone morally ought to buy lottery tickets, but instead just that if someone's goal is to win the lottery, then in order to achieve that goal, they would have to buy some lottery tickets. This kind of normativity is sometimes called prudential. Fact is, much of the recent scientific study of morality makes little attempt to clarify which sense of morality is under discussion. In fact, it's a common practice that those who advocate a science of morality, and this is pervasive as well in positive psychology, conflate the various meanings of the word as though these differences either didn't exist or they didn't matter. There are many illustrations of this in the literature, but let me focus on the example of altruism. In a recent book, biologist David Sloan Wilson argued that science can demonstrate that altruism exists. Whether this is an interesting claim depends entirely on how Wilson defines altruism. Wilson gets off to a promising start, beginning his book by defining altruism as, and I quote, "a concern for the welfare of others as an end in itself," end quote. This definition of altruism places it firmly in the prescriptive realm, given, among other reasons, the inclusion of the ideas of the goodness of intentions and a Kantian concern for human beings as ends in themselves. If Wilson could give a scientific argument for the existence of this kind of altruism, it would be a major breakthrough. But there are two different senses of altruism at play in his argument. One is prescriptive, and the other is descriptive. One is forthrightly ethical, and the other is biological. In biology, altruism is one organism's increasing another organism's reproductive fitness at a cost to its own. It stands in contrast with an ethical understanding of altruism, where the idea is in terms of one's acting with the intention of benefiting another without regard for the cost to oneself. Not surprisingly, Wilson eventually migrates away from plausibly morally relevant understandings of altruism to another more empirically tractable behavioral definition. Toward the end of the book, Wilson explains his act of redefinition. Again, I quote, "Altruism exists. If by altruism we mean traits that evolve by virtue of benefiting whole groups, despite being selectively disadvantageous within groups, then altruism indubitably exists and accounts for group-level functional organization we see in nature." This account of altruism takes us far from a recognizably prescriptive definition of altruism. Wilson is aware of this, but is unconcerned. His argument goes like this. He says that he's been critical of some of the ways that altruism is traditionally studied. Altruism is often defined, and again I'm quoting, as a particular psychological motive that leads to other-oriented behaviors, which needs to be distinguished from other kinds of motives. Once the existence of altruism hinges on distinctions among motives, it becomes difficult to study because motives are less transparent than actions. But to the degree that different psychological motives result in the same actions, we shouldn't care much about distinguishing among them, any more than we should care about being paid with cash or by a check. It's not right to privilege altruism as a psychological motive when other equivalent motives exist. So Wilson claims that whether one satisfies the biological, behavioristic definition of altruism is all that really matters. As he puts it, it doesn't matter whether he gets paid in cash or by a check. But of course, this is far from evident and will certainly face much resistance. Do you only care that your spouse acts as though she loves you? That she says complimentary things to you? That she pulls her weight on the household chores? That she contributes income to the family? That she says the things a loving spouse should say? That she appears sexually attracted to you? That she remembers your birthday, and so on? What if you discovered that she does all of these things without feeling anything for you? Or worse, she does all of these things while secretly detesting you. Wilson's claim is that this is just a cash or check situation. Just so long as she's doing all the observable things she would do if she really did love you, then the underlying motives, intentions, and desires are moot. It's difficult to imagine that Wilson himself would be indifferent to these motives and intentions. Such a relationship would be functional, but loveless, indeed, missing precisely the element that makes an act genuinely altruistic. Wilson's redefinition of the key moral term in his study ultimately renders his account incoherent, at the least, and possibly irrelevant to a science of altruism at the most. But this is the common outcome for scientific accounts that falter on the challenge of definition. In short, questions of method and measurement are critical to science, but they are irrelevant if researchers are unable to clearly mark out the object of inquiry in a credible, consistent, and persuasive manner. Conceptual clarity is essential, yet this is often missing in the new moral science. What unfolds looks like something like a shell game. Scholarship declares itself to be addressing questions of prescriptive morality, but through a sleight of hand puts descriptive and prudential definitions of morality into play in ways that conflate the meanings of the terms. The moral philosopher Joshua Green of Harvard is among the more forthright about this transvaluation. He proposes that we should revise what moral language means, moving away from concepts understood in terms of right and wrong, and instead taking moral concepts to concern serving human interests. This is a consequential move because it reframes by way of definitional fiat the terms by which morality is understood. Though the language of morality is invoked, the meaning of the term morality is now changed into something different, something that resembles common or conventional or prescriptive morality on the surface, but in fact isn't at all like it. By rendering prescriptive morality into something more amenable or naturalistic to naturalistic explanation, the meaning of morality changes into something different, into a non-prescriptive, instrumental arena of moral prudence. Owen Flanagan, also of Harvard, echoes the point, and I quote, "We are looking for norms, values, and practices that are the best, where the best is almost always the best for such and such purposes." Others also echo this point, but Alex Rosenberg of Duke is perhaps the most explicit. Reducing moral rightness to prudence produces a naturalistic grounding for morality by changing the subject. The new moral scientists are not alone here. In metaethics, the nature of morality is an open question. The new moral scientists merely take a stance in this contested realm. Thus, no one is conspiring to perpetrate a deception. Yet there is an ambiguity in the terminology that is, on the face of it, confusing. Part of the appeal of this proposal depends upon that confusion. By talking about morality as if it were what most people assume to be morality, in effect, the new moral science produces a bait and switch. Let me move to the second major point I want to make. So on what basis do prudential ethics of the new moral science rest? By what authority can ethical claims be made? Well, Joshua Green is clear, and I quote, "We have no choice but to capitalize on what values we share and seek our common currency there." Elsewhere, he writes, "We're looking for a common moral standard based on shared values. For our purposes, shared values need not be perfectly universal. They just need to be shared widely, shared by members of different tribes whose disagreements we might hope to resolve by appeal to a common moral standard. The best strategy," and again I quote, "is to seek agreement in shared values. Rather than appeal to an independent moral authority, we aim instead to establish a common currency for weighing competing values. This is the genius of utilitarianism, which establishes a common currency based on experience. We can take this kernel of personal value and turn it into a moral value by valuing it impartially. Finally, we can turn this moral value into a moral system by running it through the outcome-optimizing apparatus of the human prefrontal cortex. Flanagan echoes this view as well. He gives us the metaphor of building a bridge across a certain river. Where did this goal or end come from? And I quote, "The answer is this, it came from the people. Enough of them shared the goal of doing business with the folks on the other side of the river that seeking to meet this goal was judged to be a good idea. The same is true, I claim, for what seem to be, but are not, the more mysterious kind of normative questions that philosophers fuss with and often mystify." In the end, the utilitarianism that the new moral scientists advocate isn't driven by the greater value of some outcomes over others. It isn't driven by what is intrinsically valuable. Rather, it is driven by what people happen to value and maximizing this. So we come to the third point. What is it that people value? Framed in this way, the question of ends and goals is paramount. And this again is my third point. What are our ends or our goals? Green, for one, thinks he knows. In concert with the utilitarian tradition, he declares that we all want to be happy. None of us wants to suffer. And our concern for happiness and suffering lies beneath nearly everything else we value. Thus, and again I quote, "our task insofar as we're moral is to make the world as happy as possible, giving equal weight to everyone's happiness." So let's be clear. Green's view isn't that what we should try to make isn't that we should try to make everybody happy, because happiness is the most valuable thing. Rather, his view is that we should try to make everybody happy because that's something everybody wants. This may seem like a small and inconsequential distinction, but it isn't. What people happen to value and what really is valuable are two very different things. After all, just because people want something, even if everyone wants the same thing, in no way makes the pursuit of that thing acceptable. Some people value hoarding old newspapers, but hoarding old newspapers, at least from my perspective, isn't really valuable. On the other hand, human life really is valuable, even if no one wants it. So we see that Green makes happiness the main object of human action, not because he thinks happiness really is the greatest good. Green doesn't think anything is good at all, literally speaking. Why then happiness? His overall project is to find something everybody considers valuable and then building all of ethics on that common basis. He believes that happy experiences are this common basis, and hence his choice of a happiness-based utilitarianism. Green's views are hardly exceptional. They're shared widely by philosophers of the new moral science, and you don't need me to tell you that happiness or subjective well-being or flourishing has become a rage in psychology, as seen in the burgeoning field of positive psychology. Here too, the language of a prescriptive Aristotelian ethics is invoked, but it is, in the end, redefined into the categories of utility, functionality, and capacity, all oriented toward subjective well-being. Notions of prescriptive morality are diluted at the very least, if not emptied out altogether, of their intrinsic and substantive qualities in favor of a generic morality of strengths and utility oriented toward the ends of subjective happiness. So here I come to my fourth and final point, where I reflect a bit on where I think this takes us. Let me begin by looking at the idea of social consensus as the foundation of moral authority in this new utilitarian logic. Green and others speak about the necessity of relying upon the shared values of social consensus to build an ethics, that ethics begins with what the people want. Surely we should be cautious about that idea. After all, social consensus has given us a democratically elected Nazi party, the Third Reich, and its war machine, and in turn, the horrors of the Holocaust. Social consensus has given us a democratically validated slavery, Jim Crow, the terror of lynching, and every conceivable expression of social denigration and discrimination. Social consensus gave us apartheid in South Africa and ethnic cleansing in the Balkans. It has given us genocide in Armenia, Darfur, Burma, Rwanda, Cambodia, Somalia, and the Congo. At various times in history, social consensus has also authorized the practices of foot binding, genital mutilation, suti, suicide bombing, honor killing, unrestrained consumerism, and the like. These are not the inventions of fanatical autocrats who impose their ideas with authoritarian zeal. Rather, they have been popularly embraced by the people, woven into their cultures as well-established, if not commonplace, social practices, and reproduced generation after generation by the formal and informal socialization practices of, among other institutions, the family and school. In short, the shared values of social consensus can yield murderous results. To make such comparisons, and to see their implications, of course, one must have an elementary notion of institutions or of society. But in the new moral science, there are no such conceptualizations. The social world in all of its complexity is simply constituted by the sum total of individuals motivated by their own particular interests in order to sustain or increase their personal contentment. Institutions exist, but only as vague entities whose relative legitimacy is measured by the degree to which they increase or decrease personal satisfaction. Precisely because there is no adequate conception of the social within the new moral science, there is by extension no conceptualization of human goods that exist outside of mutually agreeable mental states of individuals. Public goods have no existence outside of individual subjectivity, no ontology, no transcendence against which the self would be held to account. How then, within the framework of the new moral science, is one to make ethical sense of the threats to our global environment, to liberty from the expanding surveillance capacities of the state, to the economy from fraud in the banking sector, to justice from the corruption of political, civic, and corporate leadership? How is one to make sense of the sacrifice necessary to achieve social justice? The new moral science provides no categories for comprehending, much less addressing, questions of collective moral failure or collective moral aspiration. The new moral science in itself provides no resources for either affirming any moral ideals or resisting any injustice common to human existence. So what about happiness or well-being as the ends of this kind of prudential ethics? Happiness or subjective well-being in the new moral science is poorly operationalized for scientific purposes. The prima facie case against it as a scientifically useful concept is very strong, for people find subjective well-being in as many different sources as one can imagine. What could be more variable? Middle-aged introspective academics, Nepalese Sherpas, horny American teenagers, religiously observant Jews, Kalahari Bushmen, Tibetan monks, members of a biker gang, construction workers, ISIS fighters, etc., etc., all find happiness in different ways. What is the happiness they share in common? Except for the word itself, what is the common currency of utilitarian exchange by which conflict would be resolved, by which justice would be pursued? On the face of it, there is no way to compare one person's happiness to another, and over time, to compare a single person's experience of happiness at one moment to anything she experiences in the past. There are no natural units by which comparison can be made. Not least, it is possible for people to find subjective well-being within regimes the new moral scientists themselves would certainly regard as evil. We know, for example, because there are accounts of this, that the years spent in the Hitler Youth were among the happiest of the lives of the 7.3 million young Nazis who went through this. For there they found camaraderie, fellowship, common purpose, opportunities to grow, develop, and work together. In that context, their PERMA levels were fantastically high. Now there was a social consensus. In the end, happiness, whether construed as subjective well-being, flourishing, PERMA, or whatever, is, as it is understood today, a highly subjective category reflecting the historically contingent cultural consensus of late modern Western middle and upper middle class liberalism. It is doubtful that that consensus is shared in Tehran, Soweto, Beijing, or in the blighted areas of LA, Washington, or Birmingham, among any of their citizens. It's dubious whether one could find a partial social consensus across those differences. But even if one could, there's a genuine question about whether it would be capable of resisting conflict or of sustaining passion toward any collective and shared moral ideals. The question will seem rhetorical, but it is entirely justifiable to ask. Would the civil rights movement in the United States have achieved its successes because of the kind of utilitarian consensus that Green and Flanagan and others speak of? Would apartheid in South Africa come to an end because people worked through the calculations of shared happiness? By contrast, could the aspirations of radical Islam be addressed through a conversation about subjective well-being? And could everyday heroism, such as caring for an elderly parent or a severely disabled child over many years, taking a risk of losing one's job for blowing the whistle on corruption at work, or providing a kidney for a stranger needing a transplant, could those things be achieved and sustained through a rational calculation of cost and benefit alone? It seems to me that we live in a world in which conflict is as present as ever, where the intentions to do harm are as ruthless as they have ever been. The means to do violence are greater than they have ever been. And thus the misery we humans are capable of inflicting on each other and to the earth are as great, if not greater, than ever before. It strikes me as minimally sensible, if not urgent, to search for any humane way through these kinds of differences. The question is, will the current science of morality, and by extension, the dominant paradigms for understanding and forming character, get us there? For all that science has taught us, and for all the good that has been brought about by it, it has not provided a Newtonian solution to the problem of morality or anything close to it. Will it ever? There are those who say we eventually will, and that it's inevitable. The problem is that this kind of promissory naturalism imputes a teleology to science that science cannot justify. The fact is, it hasn't happened yet, and we have no idea whether it will or not. What we do know is that there are formative challenges to getting there. At this stage, against the moral challenges of our age, the new moral science looks rather weak and unconvincing. Absent an engagement with history, culture, and the humanities, and absent an engagement with particular traditions of moral reasoning and practice, the new moral science appears impoverished, superficial, and trite. I believe we can do better, and for the sake of the young people in our care and the world they are inheriting, we must. Thank you.